You are under my power. Look into the hypnotic eye. Time now to enter Mr. Lobo's domain. Look out! Open your mind to the possibility that they're not bad movies, just misunderstood. You're not dreaming. You're watching cinema insomnia. Tonight, over 70% of our feature is made from recycled materials. One more way that stock film footage saves the planet by saving green for the environmentally conscious film producer. I'm Mr. Lobo.
It's a Pippin!
Welcome to the Pope on Film Special Edition. I am Bunny Williams, and with me today is not Reverend Steve, but horror host extraordinaire, Mr. Lobo of Cinema Insomnia. How are you doing today, Mr. Lobo?
I'm doing quite well, Bunny. It is a pleasure and privilege to be on this most holiest of shows.
Thank you. Thank you so much for being here today. I really do appreciate it. Absolutely love Cinema Insomnia, and we do have something in common. We actually have a few things in common, I think, but we are both saints of the Church of Ed Wood.
Very true. Yes, Saint Reverend Dr. Mr. Lobo.
I didn't get a ceremony or anything, though.
I got a candle. Steve gave me a one of those votive candles. Reverend Steve gave me one of like a prayer candle with my image on it.
Yeah.
This was at Ed Woodstock, I believe, one of those events that we did in Sacramento together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he had, shortly after we had started the podcast, he had mentioned it on the blog that he's doing it with Saint Bunny Williams, and I was like, oh, okay, there we go.
There you go, a Saint Bunny Williams. Yes. That has a nice ring to it.
And that makes me feel that it now makes no difference what religion is correct, because even if I'm wrong, even if you're wrong, we'll still get in for professional courtesy.
I think so. I can agree with that. You know, I mean, I think we can all be wrong together. What's so wrong about being wrong?
This is a good point. So, following your Facebook page, it seems like you have an awful lot going on these days.
I try to keep busy. You know, we only have so much time on this planet.
True.
Mm-hmm.
True.
I just disconnected my personal Facebook page, which was kind of a mess, and I got like 400 emails of people who thought that it meant the end of, you know, that, like, I was dying or something. Oh, Mr. Lobo, please don't leave us. It was quite disheartening to where that, for whatever reason, that has become total reality for people is your personal page on Facebook.
Yeah. I don't know. I thought it was pretty clear and understandable. You know, you've been fighting the battle to have your name, Mr. Lobo, on Facebook, and they've been fighting back quite a lot, not just with you, but with a lot of other people, in particular horror hosts themselves.
Yes. Now, I don't know if, not to get into your personal business, but, you know, I'm surprised they wouldn't accuse you of having a made-up name, since Bunny is not typical of a first name.
I am kind of waiting. I wouldn't be surprised, but Bunny is a name, you know. It's not my given name, but it's the name I go by, you know. So I'll just keep my eye on Bunny Galore and see what happens there.
Yeah, I think that, you know, it's interesting because I think because there was a victory, since we're getting into the realm of Ed Wood and transvestites and ladies and gentlemen and those undecided and the gender extra. I think that, you know, the drag queens have done a tremendous job fighting this. And I think that trying to avoid a black eye, I think Facebook has tried to comply with this contingency, but have pretty much ignored everyone else. And I fall into an interesting category of a performer with a pretty boring name. And I think that as this was falling apart and I was unable to get any sort of action, and I had a lot of friends in the drag community, mm-hmm, who were trying to help me with this, because Mr. Lobo is kind of an honorary drag queen. I'm a man dressed up like a man.
Nice.
And I got a lot of help from the drag community. But what was interesting about it is that I was unable to get my name changed. And then when I tried to, you know, a lot of people just started new accounts. Like once the rules got a little more liberal, a lot of people who had who were challenged on this started new accounts.
Yeah.
I at a certain point decided, well, I might as well, you know, it means starting over. I had 5,000 friends there. I'm going to have to go find those 5,000 friends all over again. But I'm going to go ahead and try and start a new account. And once I tried to do that, I realized that I never was able to be Mr. Lobo. I always had to step around the rules to be Mr. Lobo. I was always host Mr. Lobo or Mr. Lobo spelled strangely or Mr. Lobo combined into one word, mm-hmm, or whatever it was to kind of fool the bots to just get an account.
Yeah.
And, and I just didn't want, I just felt like I didn't want to have to play those games anymore. It's like, I want, you know, I have a fan page that's Mr. Lobo. People are looking for Mr. Lobo on Facebook. They'll find the fan page. I monitor that page. Now I have to monitor it under my wife's account, but I can still monitor the fan page, monitor the Cinema Insomnia fan page, monitor the secret groups that I have, and avoid the whole unpleasantness of having a name I don't really want on there. Mm-hmm. And also, too, you know, I kind of realized that I sort of lifted the veil a little bit too much on myself. You know, I had a lot of people asking me personal questions about my life and my family and family health issues at events and things where I'm supposed to be in character and being funny. And, yeah, and it was a challenge, and I spent 15 years building up the mystique of this character, and I felt like Facebook was tearing it down brick by brick every day I let that account stay the way that it was. So we walked away from it. A lot of people feel like I died, but I'm still around. I'm very active, and I do have a lot of events. I've got a new channel that I'm building. There's 10 new episodes of Cinema Insomnia that we're sitting on top of. We're doing another 3 brand new ones, so we're going to launch with 13 brand new Cinema Insomnia episodes on the new channel. I've got a podcast that I'm doing with the Horror News Network. I've got all kinds of things. So, I've got the Cinema Insomnia website still. I've got Outer Space International, which is my new company. I've got a lot of things going on. I'm in the Plan 9 movie. I'm in the movie Midnight Show. You know, there's so many things coming and that are here and that are going on to where I've got to be the easiest person to find on the internet. So there's really no reason, if someone wanted to know what I was doing, it shouldn't be that hard for them to keep up.
Yeah. Before we go too far, just in case any of our listeners don't know or not familiar with you, although you have come up in conversation a couple of times, obviously, can you tell us a bit about Cinema Insomnia? Tell us what the show's about and what you do?
I wish I could. That's the hardest. Right. Yeah, I could tell you a little bit about what I do. I'll try to do the short version. And I'll only go back to the 1950s. But of course, there's a tradition in this country of the horror movie host. Movie packages were sold to TV stations, and some of these movies were very good, and some of these movies were very bad. And when you're selling advertising to people, you don't want to show them the ratings of the movies that are very bad. And so it was necessary to create a format to balance out and create a consistent audience where you'd have people who would tune in every week, whether or not the movie was good or the movie was bad. And so when the shock package went out, which was Screen Gems had all the Universal movies like Frankenstein and Son of Frankenstein and other things other than Frankenstein. And then when broadcast TV started winding down, I got picked up locally on a San Francisco PBS station, which was Bob's Old Market, which Bob was very excited about.
Uh-huh.
And so was I. And then that station was swallowed by a bigger fish. And again, the world of broadcast began to wind down. And now I have episodes that I have put up on the internet. And episodes that have been on Roku, on various outlets on Roku. And I have a new channel, my own new Roku channel coming with Cinema Insomnia episodes called Outer Space International. OSI 74 is the actual channel name. And it's basically me presenting a broken down film with some humor. I am not in a Dracula cape. I have a black suit and birth control glasses.
Yes.
And a yellow rocking chair, just like Bob did on Creature Features. And we do jokes, and we have clips of old drive-in movie snack bar ads and movie trailers and interviews with the guys in the monster suits and the guys behind the camera and the guys in front of the camera. And recipes, and I have a plant that I talk to sometimes. Yes. Called Miss Mittens. And did I forget anything? I think that's it, right? That's the whole history of the whole show, right?
That sounds about the whole history, yeah. Great job. Thank you. I appreciate that description. I feel a bit cheated because I did not grow up with horror hosts. I was in New York. I like just missed Zachary.
Oh,
yeah, right? Doesn't that? Yeah. We had a lot of monster movies. We had a lot of monster shows, but no real host. WNEW Channel 5, which became Fox, they seem to have experimented with it like once or twice. You know, I kind of vaguely remember somebody being there. Rarely, you know, but no real horror host. So once and of course I've heard of them because of Famous Monsters of Filmland.
Right.
I knew what horror hosts were. And then I was really surprised in pretty much the early days of the internet to start finding out horror hosts still exist and they're still out there. And I have a lot of respect for them. And for you,
I don't know why. Seems
well, I'll get to that. It seems like one of the most pure art forms, where this is really for the love of the movies and the love of the show. because God knows none of you making money at it. You know? Whereas musicians, they may love music. Filmmakers, they may love filmmaking, but there's still that back there, you know, one day I can make a lot of money. I don't think any horror host really has that delusion.
I think some may a little bit. I think Elvira definitely gives one hope that one can make a disgusting amount of money doing this.
Yeah.
The thing about Elvira that people seem to forget, and Bob made a good living doing it as well, but the thing that people forget about Elvira is that she was excellent at marketing herself above her show.
Yeah.
So she made a fortune on costumes and keychains and calendars to buy and posters. And she had tie-ins with Pepsi and Coors.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really where she made her money as a personality, and not particularly the actual job of hosting. And Bob Wilkins, similarly, he didn't make the money hosting the movies per se, although he got a pretty decent salary doing it for Channel 2. He did it for 6 years on Channel 3, and they didn't pay him to do it. It was an extra job. He was the advertising guy.
Yeah.
But when he came to Channel 2, he had such a reputation, and he was doing it in two markets simultaneously, both in Sacramento and in San Francisco Bay Area. He owned the shows and was the producer and acquired all the advertising. So he brokered all the advertising and made really good money hosting those shows. But that's unusual. That's very that is not the norm. No one and no one goes into it for the money, for sure. And I think that it is one of those things that it is a pure art form,
mm-hmm.
and pure in the way that it's so direct, because there is always a missing ingredient. Well, it's actually a present ingredient, which is the viewer. The viewer is always included in the goings on. And there are very few people on television who are doing a show for you, who are talking directly to you. You and I are watching this movie together, and now let's enjoy it. News readers read to you. A horror host talks to you. And I think that that's part of it. I think the concept of a curator or a narrator, I think, is a strong thing, the storyteller. And it's the campfire story. You know, it's sitting with that person who's going to bring you over to the other side where all the weird stuff is. And who's greater than that than to hang out with on a Saturday night?
Almost, how do I say that word? Let me not say it. Like a shaman.
Mm-hmm.
I was going
Don't
to say.
Don't squeeze the shaman. That's what I always say.
Shamanistic, I believe, is what I was looking for, but
yes,
can't say that word.
No, you can't say it.
Now,
you can't squeeze it either. Mr. Whipple would be upset.
Yes, he would. Very much so. Now, about the new channel and just Roku in general.
Sure.
I think a lot of us were under the impression that Zombie TV was your channel. Is that not the case?
Well, there are many episodes on Zombie TV, but Zombie TV has been inactive for a good number of months now, almost a year. They're going through some changes behind the scenes.
Uh-huh.
I don't really know exactly the extent of those changes, but there has been no new content uploaded for some time. My contract with them ended in October. So I have no new contract with Zombie. They have what they have, and it will stay up there as long as the channel stays up there.
Uh-huh.
But as far as any new content, there is no new avenue for new shows to be uploaded to Zombie. So that is where that stands. I enjoyed working with Zombie. We had 5 million viewers on Zombie TV in a year.
Wow. Yeah.
So it was a very, very successful from that standpoint. Again, perhaps too successful, because now they want to go all these other directions, which may or may not include Cinema Insomnia.
So now, with launching your new Roku channel, which sounds like it's a part of a bigger enterprise.
Yes.
What things do you plan to do differently, and what things do you plan to do the same?
That's a very good question. I think that what I would like to do the same is all the things that worked on Zombie TV. With Zombie TV, we had new shows, and I think people wanted to see new shows. So I think that part is what worked, and there will be new shows. Another thing that we did on Zombie that worked really well is I wrote and produced and performed 40 commercials for Zombie TV, for different products, for different sponsors. And I very much enjoyed making commercials, as weird as that sounds. It reminded me of old television. It reminded me of the old UHF station.
Mm-hmm.
It reminded me of that feeling of somebody really being there at the station, and that it wasn't just stuff that came in a box over the front desk or something that a file that just got uploaded. You know, that there were people there who were actively doing things at the station, and so I think making commercials and making promos and all of those little kind of affects of a channel, which just seems to be absent from a lot of Roku channels. A lot of Roku channels just seem to be like a graveyard. Here's 500 public domain movies, splat. Mm-hmm. And it's like it's up to you to just kind of file through them and go, oh, well, this kind of sounds interesting. Maybe I'll watch this today. And I'm not really that. Obviously, I love films, and I love kind of, you know, whenever I've got a couple of hours, I don't mind shuffling through a bunch of icons and looking at movies I've never heard of.
Yeah.
But I really think for something to be a channel, there has to be a programming. And if there's programming, that implies a programmer. And if there's a programmer, then there's a curator, there's an archivist, there's a person that is a sensibility, a person that is connected to it, who is looking at the stuff, who is going, is this for our audience? Is it not for our audience? Is this what we want to, you know, should we, you know, we want people to see this, so let's promote it really heavily. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the aspect of Outer Space International, is that I want to be like Zombie, is that I definitely want there to be those things that I had done. I'd done a lot of branding and a lot of advertising and a lot of things for Zombie that worked, mm-hmm. that I would like to do for myself in this channel.
I think that's a really smart move, because that was a big thing watching Zombie TV for me. The interconnectedness with the commercials and the promos and things like that, which really gave it pretty much like you're saying, that you are watching a channel and there are people here, as opposed to a lot of things on Roku. I'm a big Roku fan, but a lot of the channels that are advertising are just canned advertisements, and you see the same. They'll go to a break and they'll schedule out four commercials, and it'll be the same commercial all four times, you know?
Yeah, that's awful. It is so, so disrespectful to the viewer, because it's not the type of thing where someone comes into the middle of a show like it would on a normal TV station, like, oh, well, maybe they didn't see this commercial because they're just coming into the show. It's like you've got to watch that one commercial four times before it even starts. Mm. And then you've got to watch that same commercial or same grouping of commercials repeated times through one viewing of a show. I find that very insulting to the viewer.
Right.
Because you've already had to pay that troll to start watching. And then you already know by the time there's a good example. My wife and I were watching something on Roku, and they had this cute commercial for Ritz crackers. I don't know if you've seen it, but they're like stop motion animated crackers having a football game against each other. And they have the announcers doing the color commentary,
uh-huh.
and talking about this cracker versus this cracker. And it's like the sweet versus the salty in this battle royale or whatever. And they've got these stop motion animated crackers kind of bouncing around with different toppings on them and giving you little ideas as to what you could put on your Ritz cracker. And it was so adorable and cute that Dixie was like, oh, let's get some Ritz crackers. That sounds great. You know, that sounds like, you know, I want to try the pizza Ritz cracker recipe, or I want to try the ice cream Ritz cracker recipe. Mm-hmm. And she literally was taken by the premise of the commercial. And then it aired again, and then it aired again, and then it aired again, and then it aired four times in every break. And by the time we were done with that movie, she's like, I never want to eat fucking Ritz crackers for the rest of my life. Yeah. She was so angry by the end of it that it literally turned her 180 degrees from totally wanting the product to totally not wanting the product. So, you know, I think that at a certain point, and I have to forgive me for the language.
No,
my wife is very salty. But versus sweet, she's both. But, you know, I think that at a certain point, you know, you have to ask your viewer, you have to ask yourself the question, just like if you're a filmmaker, you have to ask yourself, what movie would I dig into my pocket and pay $14 to see? That's the movie I should make.
Right.
The same regard for a television channel. What TV channel would I sit and watch is the question. And, you know, when I created Cinema Insomnia, you know, Creature Features had been off the air for 20 years. And I was flipping through the channels at 2 a.m. and was looking for a show. Cinema Insomnia was the show I was flipping through the channels looking for at 2 or 3 a.m. And I think that Outer Space International, or OSI 74, is the TV channel that I've been looking for to watch, and I haven't been finding. If I felt like somebody else was doing it, I jump on their wagon, you know?
Yeah.
I think that the other aspect of it, and going into what I want to do differently, and the harder part of it, is that I want to run it like an artist collective, where all the producers are... you know, whereas an art collective, you get a bunch of artists together and they put on a gallery show. This would be a bunch of TV producers putting on a network. And the hard part of that is coordinating not only just, you know, people are just used to just sort of dumping their show somewhere. Like on public access, you make a show and you just sort of dump it on there. On the internet, you make a show and you upload to YouTube and forget about it. What needs to happen for this to work and to really be a viable channel is that you have to make promos for your own show. You have to have things to sell. You can't complain about not making any money at what you do. Mm-hmm. If there are no deliverables, if you don't have a t-shirt or a fan club or even downloads to buy, or, you know, mm-hmm. a CD or, a book or a pamphlet or a poster, you know. So we're kind of trying to encourage people to have deliverables, things that they can have commercials for themselves, you know, or, you know, again, if they can get a sponsor, they could make commercials for their sponsor. But that I think is the complex part of this, is that, you know, it's like, hey, okay, we're all artists here. You know, this is something we want to do. We're lifers and we're committed to it. It's not going, it's going to get harder and harder to do as we get older. We have to make these things, we have to take these things to the bank and try to approach them without shame of trying to profit from them. So I think that, again, and then the cross promotion of, you know, this is my show. It comes on at 7:00 and this is what it's about. You know, I think, you know, and then that promo would be running in Cinema Insomnia for someone else's show, and my promo would be running in their show, and we would all be benefiting from that cross promotion, where when someone's watching Cinema Insomnia, Carlos Borloff pops up and says, you know, hey man, I got a show called Monster Madhouse and it comes on Friday nights and you should watch it because, you know, we do all kinds of crazy things and we've got, you know, rock and roll music and bubblegum mm-hmm. and monsters and blah, 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 blah. And then, you know, again, my viewers are getting exposed to his show. His viewers are getting exposed to my show. So not only are we kind of creating this causal loop where we're hanging on to what has become a very fickle media audience, but there are also more opportunities of buy my T-shirt. You know, I actually have a crowdfunding thing that I want to have part of, because, you know, not all people don't always want mugs and T-shirts. And I've got a crowdfunding thing for the channel called Tip Jar, where every show will have a tip jar. And rather than Kickstarter and Indiegogo, where you're paying, giving people money for something they haven't done yet, this would be giving people appreciation for work they've already done. You know, when you get your, when the guy, person washes your hair at the salon, or if someone is bringing you your food at a diner, the reason you tip them is because they work for you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they don't work for anybody else but you. They are your liaison, and you're hiring them. So, you know, to put that same aspect is we are making this show for the audience. We're not making it because someone is paying us to or demanding us to. We're making it directly for the audience. So it is on the audience that if they feel that they've been entertained, to maybe put something in the hat, you know.
You've made a lot of really, really good points there. For one, I like the idea of a tip jar a lot. I would see myself more supporting a show by donating some money to it than buying a t-shirt or something like that. DVDs, Blu-rays, that's a little different, you know? But just buying promotional items to support the show, I would rather kick into a tip jar. I understand the point with things like Kickstarter and stuff like that, giving rewards and such. Whenever I contribute to a Kickstarter, I deny the reward, because why am I giving you $25 so you can give me back $10 in merchandise? Keep the $25.
We had a successful Kickstarter campaign that was a nightmare for me.
Yeah.
It came at an interesting time where we didn't even know if we were going to try and do it. We just, you know, Dixie just said, hey, let's just try and do a Kickstarter. And, you know, the 10th anniversary of the show was coming up, and we thought, hey, let's do a Kickstarter. And we had a bunch of, premiums for people. And really the idea is that, you know, we were trying to raise $10,000. We were really just looking to put in, you know, when you broke it all out, it was only like $300 a show, which was just really just to sweeten the pot a little bit, and so that we could make the shows a little better. And, you know, once we had gotten that money, every single person that used to do us favors and worked on the show suddenly wanted money.
Mm.
And so the show suddenly became impossible to produce, because everyone thought we were rich and were full of, you know, had bags of money to spend on the show.
Yeah.
And so we had no more favors anymore, and we had no more partners anymore. Everybody wanted cold hard cash. And then there were on top of that, there were some life things that had happened where, you know, my mom, I don't want to get into it, but we had some bad issues at home where we had family health issues and things happening. And, you know, we had a lot of trouble getting people their rewards and stuff. I mean, we think we've got it to everybody. And I put out several blasts saying, hey, did you get your t-shirt or whatever? But it was very expensive to produce and mail all of the things that we promised for people. And, you know, we had a lot of people take advantage of us. We had a lot of people trick us in really weird ways that I can't even go into. And again, I mean, like I said, we only raised $11,000, but I think the damage in my reputation and the headaches of trying to, you know, suddenly in the business of merchandise fulfillment versus making a TV show.
Right.
It totally took the focus away from creating. And in the end, even though I was very honored and appreciative for everyone who believed in the show, it was kind of a mixed blessing. And going forward, I kind of feel like it gave me a black eye. I had to wait a long time for my stuff, or, you know, I never got my button, or, you know, whatever it was. Mm-hmm. And I feel terrible about this. And the other idea is that I think it changed the relationship. You know, a lot of people, when they're kicking back and they're watching their favorite show, they don't want to think about the fact of, is the host okay? Can he keep paying for this? You know, I think that it becomes you know, this is supposed to be you leave your troubles behind and you turn something on and you passively enjoy it. But when it's suddenly this thing where it's being held hostage, where you've got a gun to the head of your own baby going, okay, if we can't raise this money, I'm going to kill my baby, you know? You know, I think that, you know, and then it's all this passive aggressive. Well, I guess nobody wants a movie about llamas. You know, it's this whole kind of like crazy thing where, you know, you're developing this animosity where if the audience doesn't give you some money to make a show for them, that they somehow hate what you do or whatever. And a lot of it is just timing. And, you know, a lot of people you'll find out afterwards never even heard that you were doing a Kickstarter. I mean, yeah. We have this distorted view that everything that we put out there is seen by everyone. And it's just not true. I think only 10% of your Facebook friends see the things that you post. And, mm-hmm. and you know, everyone is so distracted that it's very easy for major campaigns to go unnoticed. And to be honest, a lot of the Kickstarter stuff it was a joke. I mean, the stuff that made millions was stuff that people did on a lark because, you know, it's just a game for them. It's not like they really cared about making the world's best potato salad, you know.
Right.
It just it was funny, a funny idea to give some kids a buck to make potato salad. And, you know, 10, you know, whatever, 50,000 or however many people did the same thing. And so you've got someone who's making potato salad with $50,000, where you have, you know, some disabled filmmaker who wants to tell a personal story who can't raise, you know, $5,000.
Right.
So, you know, and has to go away from a Kickstarter, even though their thing was very worthy. So go away empty handed, rather. So, you know, I was involved recently with a movie called Midnight Show, which was done without any help from Kickstarter or any crowdfunding. And they just did it all on favors from people who were in the industry who just really wanted to do something fun.
Yeah.
And I was very inspired by this. And I participated in several of the segments of the Midnight Show film. And it definitely was one of the key components of what I wanted for the channel, is to try to activate people who are artists, you know, because people forget that people who make TV shows, you know, even though it's sexy to talk about indie filmmakers and indie rock performers, indie television producers are artists too. And and you know, I think that, you know, a lot of us are doing it because we love it. We have a story to tell. We have a way of expressing ourselves. We have a following, and we have a niche. And I think that so that's kind of, I guess, the cornerstone of starting a network is to try to kind of cull together people of with a similar sensibility and find ways of making it work so that we can, again, hold on to the rights to our own thing, because I don't want to own anybody's show.
Right.
Like I wouldn't want someone to own my show. Mm-hmm. You know, there've been so many contracts that have been put under my nose that I have pushed away. They were like stereo instructions, and they would own Cinema Insomnia forever. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's like I know too many sad stories from people who created a TV show or created a movie, and they signed on the dotted line, and somebody just locked their baby up in a vault, and they never were able to do anything. And that's too terrifying to give an entity, a corporate entity, permission to unplug you. And this character is not just a character; it's part of my own personality. This show that I do is not just a show; it's an expression of my art. So I can't. It is just not feasible for me, no matter how much money is involved, to give that power of someone to, you know what, we're going to have someone else be Mr. Lobo. And, you know, we're going to change the show to Cinnamon Sodomy, you know, and, you know, or whatever. And you can't.
Now that I might tune into, though, to be honest.
Cinnamon Sodomy tonight, yes, with Dr. Lobo. So, you know, it's just like, I can't, you know, and I have so many good friends who have projects, and so many people who it's like, I wish I could take on everybody, and it's a difficulty because I've kind of opened the floodgates. I have, a lot of, on a daily basis, people presenting shows to me potentially for the network.
Right.
And I'm not saying no to anyone, because really at this stage, I don't really know what we're looking for.
I did it too, but I don't really want to talk about it here. This is your time, but I did it to you too.
which I appreciate, you know, because again, you're bringing me your baby, and I have 100% appreciation for that. It's just in from where I'm standing, I have to look at it, and again, I like what you do, but I have to also think, okay, I have to find the right time slot for this. I have to find a right place to present this, and then we also have to make promos and you know, have to make this thing somewhat work for you, so that it's right. You know, right. Where in the long term it makes sense for you to keep doing it, just as much as it will make sense for us to keep doing it.
Well, this is one of those things where I'm going to keep doing it regardless of what happens. That's just sure. That's just how it is. I have a lot of fun doing it. I take no responsibility for what my character does. Not at all.
Well, like I said, I really appreciate what you do, and I definitely find it subversive and funny. We don't necessarily need to do this on the air, but I think that what would be a fun thing to do, and maybe something to coordinate, is to create a larger project that could contain what you do in your character, and maybe Reverend Steve. And, mm-hmm. and maybe make like a Church of Ed Wood hour or something, and, you know, kind of cull together a bunch of like-minded offbeat material into one program it's that we can kind of, promote. Who knows? I mean, that's just an idea off the top of my head, but there could be a million things we could do with your content.
So how do you feel about YouTube?
That's a really good question. I have a lot of negative feelings about YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that I came from the world of TV and radio. I went to school for broadcasting. I got a broadcaster's license. I worked at a TV station. I worked in radio. I always kind of came from an aspect of I didn't really invest a lot into the new media stuff until it was too late. So a lot of that is shame on me. I had a very successful YouTube channel that I started in 2009, I believe. And we had 40 Cinema Insomnia episodes up to view.
Mm-hmm.
And we had 500 subscribers and millions of views total. And what was upsetting about it is that we got dinged for copyright infringement.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we try to do our due diligence. A lot of the stuff is gray area. A lot of the stuff would be fair use, because we're presenting it in a certain context that needs to be understood.
Right.
But it, you know, the robots aren't looking for that. It's just, if the audio matches, they just count it as a ding. And, so, you know, we had, two strikes. The first strike, we were looking to get cleared up, because it was like House on a Haunted Hill or something that Warner Brothers said that they owned, which really they didn't.
Yeah.
And, the other thing was a Tupperware commercial. That was a public domain Tupperware commercial, but the public domain Tupperware commercial was also used on a record album. And since the audio matched up on this record album, they were claiming we were using copyright material, but we were both borrowing something from the public domain. It's just that their album is a registered piece and ours is not.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were waiting for... again, I think it was Warner Brothers or some giant entity to watch a 2-hour program and determine if 30 seconds of it was infringing against them.
Mm-hmm.
And while we were waiting for this, a third strike came.
Yeah.
And we don't know what that third strike was, because I was unable to log into my account anymore.
Uh-huh.
And all those 40 episodes vanished from YouTube that took hours to upload.
Yeah.
And so I had walked away from YouTube. I was so angry that I never looked back. I haven't anything that's on YouTube has been uploaded by fans. And I ended up serving my own video on Lobo Vision, which is an offshoot of my website. And then I ended up putting some stuff on Vimeo, and I ended up putting stuff other places. I know a lot of people who have some success, you know, once they get enough views, I guess they can make money off the advertising. Certainly they're not making nearly the money that YouTube is making.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, I just think a lot of the stuff gets lost in the shuffle. I think people get very disheartened if something only has like 11 views when they put their heart and soul into it. And then you have a lot of people saying negative, awful things, which does nothing but subtract to the entertainment value of what you're watching.
Yeah.
So I think that it's Poverty Row TV, as far as I'm concerned. Mm-hmm. It's a passive aggressive audience where they don't want to put anything into it, yet they will quickly tear it down. If it's not exactly what they want, when they're not willing to pay anything to watch it.
So, it seems like they don't kick you off YouTube as quick anymore. But for me at this point, I've stopped caring. I don't really care about what I'm not going to be careful about my content anymore. If regardless of what I do, I'm going to get dinged on something.
Yeah.
You know, I fairly recently did a tutorial for how to do the effect from the opening of Daredevil.
Oh yeah, uh-huh.
And I decided to have a little more fun with the tutorial as opposed to the very dry kind of you do this. So I started chucking in other shorts and things like that I had. And I had background music and things like that. And they dinged that. Everything except for one piece, was all of mine. All of the music was mine. I have a person who does my music and I pay her for that.
Yeah.
So that's all my music. That's all original content.
Right.
I had done a commercial for Black Dress Warehouse, which was a commercial that Reverend Steve did on one of our Pope on Film episodes for our Carnival of Souls episode. Mm-hmm. So I clipped out Carnival of Souls and I made a nice little video with his commercial audio.
Yeah.
And I used the opening music from Glenn or Glenda. And that's got to be what they dinged it on. It's the only possible thing.
Wow.
So I'm just, you know, at this point, it's like, ding it. What do I care? You know?
Let me just get it out there. The bad part is that they'll shut down your whole channel. That's the bad part.
Then I'll find someplace else to go. Yeah. You know? Yeah. It's one of those things where I don't feel it's something I can worry about. You know, I only need to worry about the content that I'm trying to put out.
Well, yeah, and again, if ultimately, you know, you are doing this for you, mm-hmm. you know, then you will always find another way to get it out there. And that's what I did, is I just found different ways to get it out there. And that's the thing that I'm dealing with all the producers I'm working with. You know, everyone calls me and they have all these concerns as to how we're going to compete in this marketplace. You know, Borloff will call and say, okay, hey man, I got this idea, you know, this cat video got 9 million hits, you know, so let's just, you know, we can push a cat off a table and, you know, film it. And it's like, well, it doesn't really work that way, because, you know, that's like playing the lotto or going to Vegas. It's like, you can't create a viral video.
No.
And I don't really want to. I didn't get into this business to push cats off of tables. That's not what motivates me.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, I feel like, and I'm picking on Borloff. He never said any of that.
Okay.
But you know, the idea of it is that, you know, producers are constantly trying to, you know, they're letting this damaged culture dictate what they're going to do. It's like, mm-hmm. you don't need to do that. You know, you just need to do what you want to do, do what you want to see, you know? And so that's the part that I think is going to be different about this channel, because what I really want to do with this channel is counter program. If somebody else is already got the reality shows covered, you know, somebody right. else is already pushing cats off of tables. I don't, you know, or getting hit in the crotch with a softball or whatever, you know, setting gummy bears on fire, mm-hmm. whatever people want to, you know, whatever clickbait people want to look at. I can't compete with that. It's foolish for me to try to compete with that. I'm not trying to compete with the major networks. I'm not trying to compete with YouTube. You know, I'm trying to create a niche. You know, most of the stuff is offbeat. Most of the stuff has some kind of sense of humor, and I can visualize across pollinization. Is that even a word?
That is a word.
Across pollinization of the things that we've acquired, to where we can kind of build an audience. But, you know, there's no way, you know, I mean, we can't compete with Netflix. We can't compete with YouTube. You know, we really need to just come up with, really create our own genre where people are who come to the channel expecting a certain sensibility. Just like when you read a magazine, you know, you read Mad Magazine, mm-hmm. it's all coming from different places, but there's a prevailing sensibility that sort of keeps you with everything.
Right.
And I think that the world of Roku is very much like the print world. You know, it's all about impressions and page views, and I think it's a lot like publishing. And so I'm kind of, other than an art collective and a community television station, you know, I'm also kind of looking at it like a magazine where you've got departments and editors, and you just kind of, you know, you're looking for stuff that sort of works and programming it.
Yeah.
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 Now, a more serious question.
Yes.
If you had to drive one animal species to extinction.
Yes.
So that no other animal species ever becomes extinct again.
Yes.
What animal would that be?
Chris Jericho.
Chris Jericho.
That was easy.
That was easy. Chris Jericho. I might have to see if I can get him for an interview now.
Yeah. Good luck.
Chris Jericho.
Yeah, I don't know if you remember that whole scandal with Chris Jericho.
I do. He had made some racial slurs during a show of yours. Yes.
Racial and lifestyle slurs, both, which I thought was interesting.
Yeah.
Inaccurate, but interesting. My friend Keith Wool Jensen, who's a stand-up comedian, he's a very intelligent and well-spoken guy, and a lot of people think he's gay.
Right.
He came up with a theory that the dumber you are, the more people you think are gay, because they speak well. And think better than you. So,
that might be a valid point. That makes some sense.
So, I was at the Sacramento Horror Film Festival, and we had Chris Jericho as a guest, as well as the director of the film that Chris Jericho had a I would say supporting role in. It wasn't like the movie was about his character.
Mm-hmm.
And Chris Jericho, I mean, I really wanted to interview the director of the film and really sort of get his impression of his own work as the author of his work. And Chris Jericho was so belligerent and domineering that I started to tease him a little bit by sniffing his drink.
Okay.
And he said, "It's apple juice, fag." That was what he said to me. Mm. And which it wasn't, but that's a whole nother story. You know, the other thing, he said, kept calling me Haji.
Right.
Which I guess, you know, what, Johnny Quest is what? Where do we talk? Where is that coming from? You know, the only brown person he ever saw on TV was on Johnny Quest, I guess. I don't know. But he started calling me Haji. And so between fag and Haji, it got the attention of TMZ.
Right.
And it was a worldwide scandal. I mean, they had Hulk Hogan weighing in on the Mr. Lobo incident. I have an incident named after me because of this guy. And I had
that's something to be proud of,
I guess. But I was afraid to leave my house. I had wrestling fans wanting to kill me. And it was a miserable 2 weeks where I had a lot of people challenging me and thinking that I was trying to ride Chris Jericho's coattails or that I was a crybaby. All of these things, I had TMZ putting words in my mouth about how I felt about what had happened.
Yeah.
I had Chris Jericho lying and saying it was planned all the time, that we were doing an Andy Kaufman kind of thing. And so I created a fake press conference where I had a neck brace. And I made it into a big spoof, when I made fun of myself. I made fun of TMZ. I made fun of the media. I made fun of the incident. I made fun of Chris Jericho. And it just deflated it like a balloon. I just used my powers of satire to kill that scandal. And Chris Jericho tweeted that I was the man, and it was over. And and that was it.
Cool. You ended it on your terms. So very good there.
It was terrible. It was terrifying, though, because people constantly think, "Oh, that must have been so great. Oh, that, you know, that was some great free publicity." It's like, no, it was miserable, you know. Yeah. And it's like, and those people, people, you know, aren't. I don't think I gained one fan from that whole charade, mm-hmm. but I think he lost some.
Yeah.
And so that's that. You know, I guess, like I said, that's not the kind of publicity I really want. I want people who enjoy my sense of humor and I like the show. I don't want people to watch because of some morbid curiosity or because of some kind of scandal. It's really not I'm really not interested in that kind of attention.
Yeah. So tell me about this podcast of yours.
Not a lot to tell yet. I was approached by the Horror News Network. They really want to develop a podcast with me. They have a lot of connections in that world of podcasts. And they are looking to actually produce it. So at least I won't, you know, all I have to do is talk into a microphone or a telephone.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
You know, and then they can kind of, they'll be booking guests and taking care of, you know, screening calls and doing all that kind of stuff.
Good.
We're going to call it Sleepless Nights with Mr. Lobo. Mm-hmm. And it will be sort of like a talk show. I wanted to do a talk show with Zombie and that didn't really come to fruition. So this will kind of, in a weird way, be a sideways extension of that, where it will be a talk show for the ear, and yeah. we'll have guests, we'll have segments. I won't have a top 10, but you know, I'll have desk pieces like that, and we'll have phone in, call in, live calls, and it'll probably be Monday or Tuesdays, and there'll be information about it on cinemainsomnia.com and the Horror News Network.
And
horrornews.net.
Would that be released on iTunes, or is that something that you're not a part of?
I think it will be in, I don't want to sound stupid, but I think all of that. I think it will, you know, all of the usual avenues for podcasts, I think that they are integrated into all of that, so... However, people get their podcasts, and I'm probably including iTunes. Yes, I will just say yes.
Yeah. Well, I hope that you have every bit as much fun with yours as I do with mine, because I have a blast.
That's good.
Absolute blast. And it just wound up just clicking right, you know, where Reverend Steve pretty much handles all of the actual content of the show.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just his Ed McMahon.
Yeah.
You know, I just show up and then I do all the heavy lifting in the background. Getting that the sounds, advertising sounds out great. There.
Well, you know, I'm glad. I mean, I really enjoy Reverend Steve, and I enjoy you. I mean, we've had a long sort of association for a long time. It's nice mm-hmm. to finally be able to actually talk with you.
Well, we're like DNA. You know, the strands come together, and then they go apart, and they come back together, and they go apart.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how things should go. You know?
Yeah. Orbits. We have yeah. sort of colliding orbits from time to time.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
I definitely think there'll be more for us to do together on OSI, and it would be fun to get Reverend Steve on there too.
Yeah, yeah. I have been. I've brought it up to him, and he's kind of interested. I would really like to see him do some videos of the Lessons of Wood. I'd like to see him do a show like that.
I would too. I mean, I think that would be something good for Sunday mornings, you know?
Yeah.
We could do a kind of a public service where we're putting those sermons out there so that people can get the good word.
Yes. Yes. So how did you two meet? I know you did Ed Woodstock, you did a couple of other things. He is on a couple of the episodes of Cinema and Snomania, Star Crash, and I forget what the other one is.
Bucket of Blood.
Bucket of Blood, right.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because I've always been obsessed with Ed Wood. Obsessed maybe. Maybe that is the right word, obsessed with Ed Wood. I think a lot of people who enjoy cult films kind of find him to be the icon, you know, of the mm-hmm. of the cult filmmaker or the B movie filmmaker, and certainly an independent spirit, you know. He was a prolific artist and an exploitation artist.
Yes,
he was very good at what he did. He just was. He's spreading himself very thin. He's trying to do the work of 10 people.
Right.
Probably one of America's most prolific authors, actually. If you take into account all the books and smut and things that he wrote.
Yes.
And all the movies he ghostwritten, because you know, when you can write a movie in 2 days, you know, you get that rep and people come to you and they want you to ghostwrite for them. Mm-hmm. So there are many, many movies out there that, you know, you never know which ones, but when you watch them and you feel like, wow, it feels like Ed Wood is in there somewhere. You could be right. He could have actually written it. But I reached out to Reverend. I was looking for Criswell stuff online.
Right.
And I had come across Reverend Steve's website. And I was in Sacramento. And at that time, I believe he was in Arizona. If I'm not mistaken, Reverend Steve will correct me if I'm wrong. And I had just reached out to him and I had said, you know, I really like what you're doing. And I like this whole Church of Ed Wood thing. It would be something fun to incorporate with Cinema Insomnia.
Mm-hmm.
And he had said, by coincidence, I'm moving to Sacramento. And so that was really surprising that at that exact time I was reaching out to him, he was moving into my backyard.
Yeah.
And so it was. It seemed like that it was a sign, you know, that we should work together. And he was very excited that I was a horror host because, as you know, Vampyra and Criswell are both kind of horror hosts in their own way. And you know, Criswell was certainly Ed Wood's narrator / storyteller.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, Bela certainly has filled that role as the storyteller and the puppet master. And so that's something, again, that tradition is in Ed Wood's work. There's always the storyteller. And Reverend Steve liked my show, and we had met, and I had done a lot of work to bring Tim Burton's film to Sacramento as a midnight movie. Because it did not have it had a very short run. The 1994 film had a very short run in Sacramento, and a lot of people did not get to see it on the big screen. So we did a presentation of Ed Wood, Tim Burton's Ed Wood, in black and of course in black and white, because that's how the only way you can watch it. But we had recreated the graveyard from Plan 9 on stage, and we had Reverend Steve on as a special guest. And then from that, we started talking about Ed Woodstock. I also presented Plan 9 and 16mm as an event. And we had a person dressed as Tor and Vampira, and we had flying saucers that we threw into the audience that had numbered plans on them. And whoever had Plan 9 brought it up and got a prize. Saucer Vision, I think, is what it was. We were throwing them out during the movie.
Nice.
And, so because of this and my commitment to Ed Wood, I think it is probably what made Steve make me because I'm a horror host, and because I have presented the work of Wood in live venues for people to come and see. I think those are probably the reasons why he made me a saint. So we put together Ed Woodstock, which was two movies and three live bands.
So you didn't have to pay him? I had to pay him.
You had to pay what, Reverend Steve?
Yeah, $500.
Really?
To get a sainthood.
Wow.
No, I'm lying. I'm totally lying.
To say, $500 in my pocket. So we did Ed Woodstock at the Crest Theater. We had about, I think, 85 or something come out on a Sunday to do. And it was, to be honest, I think it killed my reputation with the Crest Theater, but it was worth doing. It ended up raining, so it kept a lot of people away. Again, we had like 85 people, I think, and it was an enjoyable time, a good time, and it definitely was a bonding experience for Reverend Steve and I. And from that, we had him on the Bucket of Blood episode and the Star Crash episode, and I don't think there's another one. He's been mentioned, I think. I think I've sort of dropped his name in scripts here and there to know that he's part of Mr. Lobo's universe, but... I think we've only had him physically in the show twice.
Yeah. I think his daughter Emerald is in a Bigfoot sketch he had mentioned.
Oh, huh. That's possible. There's a lot of segments in the Bigfoot episode, and some of them are in one of them is in a school, and one of them is in other places. So it may be that she's in the background somewhere in another episode. That's very possible.
Yeah. Ed Wood for me is, and I say this kindly, but he is the avatar of failure. He is the embodiment of failure, and because of that, teaches me to not be afraid of failure and to keep trying.
Yes.
Regardless of what you're up against. And even if what you're turning out is bad, if that is what you want to be doing, keep doing it.
Yes, I definitely I can grok what you're saying, Bunny, there. And I would add to that that if at first you don't succeed, redefine your definition of success. Because I think that, you know, we growing up in a capitalistic society, we measure success a certain way.
Right.
Are we making money? How are you doing? You making money? That's what everyone wants to hear.
Yeah.
But the thing is, you can't take it with you.
No.
And in the end, we're all dirt poor, mm-hmm. about 6 feet of dirt.
Well, there's also a saying that I have stolen from you. I'm not sure who you stole it from. There's somebody at the door. We need to take a quick break.
Let's see who is at the door, shall we?
Faye Ray. Janet Lee. Adrian King. Heather Langenkamp. Amy Steele. That weatherman who saw the cockroach.
Oh my god!
Jamie Lee Curtis. And you. Come on. You know you wanna. Let her rip. There. Now don't you feel better? You are now officially a Scream Queen. Come play with the rest of us at www.screamqueens.com. That's Queens with a Z. Or you could subscribe to us on iTunes. Either way, it's gonna be fucking fabulous. The Scream Queens Horror Podcast. It's where horror gets bent.
Hey, listen, fuckwad. I know you want to talk back sometimes. Sometimes it's just listening. But sometimes you just gotta... You want to talk back to the Pope on Film? The fuck? Like our Facebook page by searching Pope on Film. Follow us on Twitter at Pope on Film. Or you can email us at pope@undeadcow.com, okay? Not sure how to listen? Find us at iTunes Store by searching Undead Cow. Check us out on YouTube at youtube.com/users/undeadcowfilm. Or you can find us at Stitcher. It's the app that's located right next to your app featuring the EVT card.
What's that sound? Coming to you through the electric mist, it's the Midnight Cinephile, with new episodes every Wednesday night.
Wow, my brain was going crazy trying to imagine what they're just setting in your house until tomorrow.
It's a strange situation. The manager of the apartment complex is really pretty cool, but then she has corporate bosses that are really dicks.
Ah.
So my girlfriend is interested in gardening.
Yes.
And artistic expressions in gardening.
Ah, yes.
It's called garden junk.
Yes.
Where she will take strange items, plant things in them.
Yes.
Corporate is having a really big problem with this.
Oh, that's too bad. So I've seen this where they take an old chair or something and then the vines grow on top of it or whatever. Is that kind of thing?
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
She has recently taken to scalping troll dolls and then planting things in the tops of their heads.
Nice.
They are pretty awesome looking.
That sounds awesome.
So that's what that was.
Okay. That's interesting. Well, again, it's again expressing yourself and not always being appreciated by the powers that be. Ed Wood would definitely get behind that. And I think that there is something that, I mean, I've never got to talk with anyone involved with Ed Wood. Actually, that's not true. I did talk to Conrad a lot because we made Plan 9 together.
Yes.
And what I think is really interesting about Conrad and all of those guys is that they were immune to criticism.
Mm-hmm.
Criswell was immune to criticism. Vampira was immune to criticism. And they were all kind of the misfits. They were all kind of, you know, people joked about them and made fun of them and discredited them. And, you know, in the end, they just kind of kept going.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, they can only take it away from you if you let them. And, you know, Ed Wood, for some way, just persevered and just kept doing stuff. And when he couldn't do stuff, he just did other stuff. He never stopped doing things. He never stopped writing. Ed Wood started filming movies because he was, you know, again, he was a fast writer, you know, Guinness Book typist, and he could write a movie in a matter of days, which was unheard of.
Yeah.
And he wrote a lot of Westerns and things for other people. He wrote The Violent Years and other movies. And, you know, people went and were very successful with those movies. And those directors made lots of money. So really, him directing was just kind of in defense of his writing. It was like, you know, about Ed Wood, and I'm going to say something here that is going, I think, going to be a bombshell.
Okay.
Can you hear me still?
We had a little connectivity problem, I think.
I'm gonna go with just the audio.
Okay.
So, I think Ed Wood, you know, Tim Burton, we think of all our filmmakers as like John Carpenter or Tim Burton. We think of them as an island, you know, this genius that, you know, has this vision and knows exactly what they're doing. And they are to a certain extent, but they have an ensemble. They have their support team. They have the people they've been working with and they keep working with on every project. So their projects all have the same feel. They're an auteur, but there's an ensemble at work that keeps it going and keeps that person's vision intact. And Ed Wood had a cinematographer that is rarely talked about. You know, he's a one line joke in the Ed Wood film, the Tim Burton film.
Yeah.
The guy who doesn't know what color the dress is because he's colorblind.
Yes.
But that guy, the cinematographer, William C. Thompson, I believe it's William C. Thompson. Correct me if I'm wrong. Cinematographer for Ed Wood, or Ed Wood cinematographer, worked in silent films, worked with Bela Lugosi on some of the old, you know, he worked on White Pongo and a lot of other sci-fi films like Not of This Earth.
Uh-huh.
And I wish I could pull a bunch of the others out, but he was a genre director from the silent era. He had one eye, and when people were going into Panavision and stuff like that, and when we moved out of the silent era, he became one of those misfits, even though he was a top cinematographer in his own day.
Mm-hmm.
And so I believe a lot of the staginess that Ed Wood's films have is because of William C. Thompson's eye. It's a guy from the 30s making a movie in the 60s.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And you've got that kind of classic sort of staginess of an adventure serial happening in a more contemporary movie. And I think that that's part of, you know, if what gives Ed Wood's films almost a dreamy quality that a lot of silent films have.
Yeah.
You know, when William C. Thompson, and let me state this, that he did the cinematography for all of Ed Wood's major films, all of them, Glen or Glenda, Plan 9, Bride of the Monster, all the ones that were shot on 35 and were legitimate films he worked on. And mm-hmm. when he passed away, Ed Wood no longer had a man behind the camera.
Uh-huh.
And so from the 60s forward, it was all porno for Ed. And I think that that's because he did not have the cinematography skills necessary to make a passing film, you know, for major distribution. And that is my theory. I would love for someone to come up and tell me wrong, but I think that there is a untold story of a partnership, an untold story of a duocracy, if you will,
yes,
between the director and the cinematographer. And you need both. You need the guy who talks to the actors and the guy who has the vision and the story. And you need the eye. You need the guy who can put that vision onto celluloid. So I think we got off track, but again, I think that it was another misfit that Ed had collected into his ensemble that creates his world and creates that vision that we see with Ed's work. And I think that going back to what you were saying about success and failure, mm-hmm. you know, he allowed a lot of people who could not or would not get work in the studio system. He allowed them to keep making movies. You know, he not only made an audience, he not only found an audience and made, a lot of people happy with his work and influenced a lot of filmmakers. He also gave a lot of people who were chewed up and spit out by the industry the dignity of work.
Yeah. Yeah,
and I think that is a way, getting choked up here, but in a measure of a man to look after your friends and your be a collaborator, and to look after our older people, you know, people mm-hmm. who he was a fan of Bela, and he was probably a fan of William C. Thompson. He probably was. He was a fan of Vampira. You know, these were people that he saw the value in. And whether or not they were blacklisted or considered a drunk or considered a morphine addict or, you know, undesirable because of their lifestyle, he completely forgave all of that and only saw them for the quality of their work. And so I think that, like I said, I think that as a savior and as a, you know, he definitely is the poster child for what's considered commercial failure.
Mm-hmm.
And definitely he had a lot of demons and things that he never really got to work out as far as alcoholism. Primarily, I think alcoholism is definitely the big demon that Ed Wood finally succumbed to.
Mm-hmm.
But apart from that, these people were his friends and he looked after them and they looked after him. And I think that's part of what shows or what prevails in these films.
Well, when you have a good, bad movie, you can see the love. You can see that whether Ed Wood accomplished his goal competently or not, you can see that he loved that project. You know, and
yeah.
That's a success.
Yes. And I think, too, alchemy. And I've said this before. I said this on the Mystery Science Theater box set for Bride of the Monster. Ed Wood was not a filmmaker. He was an alchemist.
Yeah.
It wasn't the choice between making a good movie and making a bad movie. It was making a movie and not making a movie at all.
Right.
And he somehow put two and two together and came up with seven.
Mm-hmm.
And those movies shouldn't even exist because there really aren't enough parts to even make a movie.
Right.
He somehow made a movie anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And several times.
Oh, good God, yeah.
And that's a lot of finagling and chicanery and a lot of other long words.
Mm-hmm.
And that is different. He's a showman, and he just sort of put the show on at any cost. And a lot of people don't have that kind of courage. It's like, if it's not exactly perfect, they don't follow through.
Right.
And Ed Wood, in the end, was a producer, and he delivered. You know, if he committed to it, he followed through.
Well, that's where you have to dare to suck, you know? And that's a good thing. You know, I mean, why do people expect to walk out and be like, oh, okay, I'm going to go make a movie and have that be great? Where does that happen? You know, if you pick up a guitar for the first time in your life, you're going to suck. That's just how it is. And you have to just accept that. And if that's what you want to do, you keep doing it and you improve and you get better.
Sure. And sometimes you don't.
And sometimes you don't, which brings me back to Ed Wood being such an avatar of failure, because God love him, he never did. And I find that mystical and divine that he didn't. Like, there is a grand plan why he didn't ever get better.
Yeah. Because
we need him not to get better. We need him to stay the bad filmmaker.
Yeah, that would have been really interesting if he pulled a James Cameron and went from Piranha 2 to Terminator.
Yeah, right? You
know, it would have been interesting.
I think we would be missing something if that happened.
I think so. But I don't know if it would necessarily undo the wonderment of those early films, but yeah. It is interesting. They all kind of exist within a similar time period. I kind of put him in the same category as Jack Arnold.
Mm-hmm.
Jack Arnold did Creature from the Black Lagoon and Revenge of the Creature, and It Came from Outer Space, and The Incredible Shrinking Man, and so many wonderful sci-fi films for Universal for the 50s.
Great.
And once the 60s happened, he was just he was a square peg in a round hole. He didn't fit with what was happening in movies. And by the time the 70s got there, he was really out of it. He didn't like movies like The Exorcist or whatever. And he didn't have that sort of cynicism.
Mm-hmm.
And he couldn't build a movie on atmosphere the way he likes to. And he just worked in television. He directed episodes of Gilligan's Island, and he directed episodes of Wonder Woman, and just fell out of the film industry as we know it. And work mainly in TV, but those movies stand as an era. You know, they don't necessarily fit together, but they all have that great gee whiz 50s sci-fi feel. Yeah. And all of Ed Wood's films fit in this universe that he's created, where there's the bumbling cops and, you know, there's the old house at the edge of town where all the weird stuff happens in the graveyard. And they're all kind of bubbling out of this sense of this certain sensibility. Mm-hmm. And they're perfectly preserved in that way because, you know, other than the stuff like Orgy of the Dead, which, you know, again, is a totally different kind of film.
Yes, we covered that.
You know, everything has a, you know, and even Orgy of the Dead still kind of has a early 60s, late 50s sort of sensibility to it, even though it's in the 70s. But I think that, again, for most people, it's those few movies, Glenn or Glenda, Bride of the Monster, Plan 9. You know, you could even put Violent Years in there and some of the other ones that he had strong connection to.
Yeah.
That are our Jailbait.
Night of the Ghouls.
Night of the Ghouls, right. Mm-hmm. They all kind of congeal and sort of fit together. And it's a time and a place and a sensibility and a world. And I think it just makes it a very special kind of bygone place that just you know, that where all the Ed Wood stuff happens.
Mm-hmm. As opposed to some things that we're getting these days, like Sharknado, which we also covered, where apparently you can set out to make a bad movie. You know, you yes. can launch off with that in mind, but it's just not the same. You know, you watch something like Sharknado and there's always the feeling of, look at that. Did you see that? That was funny, right? Did you see that? That was really campy, right? You know?
Yeah. A winking at the camera and sort of being self-aware. You know, I have never seen Sharknado just because, to be honest, it didn't turn me on from anything I saw, like from the trailers or anything. I never saw, oh, wow, I got to sit down and see this movie.
Yeah.
Which is really what a good exploitation movie does, is that there's some aspect to it that you feel like, oh, I have to see this just mm-hmm. to see it play out. I haven't taken the time to watch Sharknado, so I can't fully criticize it. I do feel like if you try to make a bad movie on purpose and you succeed, did you succeed or did you fail?
That is a good point. Yeah.
So I don't know. You know, I mean, I think that it's possible, and I like the idea of there being a B movie. There, for a long time, there was no B movie market of any sort.
Right.
And an exploitation film. A lot of people don't understand what an exploitation film is. An exploitation film is sold entirely on the subject matter.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not on big stars or big special effects or big money. You are going into it because you want to see a Sharknado.
Right.
And what that is, you know? So I think that from that standpoint, it's exciting that we're living in an era, you know, like there was in the mom and pop video store era, where there was this kind of giant hole, machine that just wanted a bunch of brainless exploitation films, and it created a whole demand that was then filled. The same with the drive-in movie market. There was such a demand for content that, you know, it was, you know, okay, amazing two-headed transplant. Let's go. You know,
yeah.
Like people mm-hmm. were just trying to create that kind of content where the subject matter alone, despite the lack of a budget or stars, would draw in a crowd. And, you know, I think zombie movies are like that. I think, you know, whatever, Lone Shark versus Octomom or whatever mm-hmm. they are, I think, you know, yeah. all those yeah. kinds of movies are that kind of movie. So even though I don't necessarily may not be that interested to see Lone Shark versus Octomom, I was interested to see Iron Sky, you know, or, you know, Machete, or, you know, those are actually more big budget movies, but. Yeah. But, you know, yeah. the premise of it was interesting, and I wanted to see it based on that premise.
Yeah.
And to just see it play out. And I think that we do live in a mixed blessing, whereas the B movies are back. The only thing about it is that, you know, again, it's the. We did it bad on purpose, so you can't criticize it.
Right.
And in the regard, and the thing is that Ed Wood didn't have that option, you know, mm-hmm. no one, he couldn't just say, oh, well, I was making it bad on purpose.
Right. Uh-huh.
And so, you know, at a certain point, you just got to stand behind what you're doing. And, you know, again, it's the thing that I think I said earlier. You have to make the movie you want to see. Do you really want to see a movie about a shark tornado? Or is this some sort of idea of what you think a cult movie fan wants to see?
Well, it comes down to the same thing as shoving a cat off a table.
Right.
You know, do you want to shove the cat off a table? I mean, you could want that, and then we're talking about something else. But if you're like, oh, cats getting shoved off of things, that's really hot now, so we have to do that. Where you're compromising the art for money or views or likes or subscriptions or anything like that.
Well, and to be fair, I think Ed Wood did probably do a little bit of, oh, the kids like the sci-fi and the kids like the, you know, that Day the Earth Stood Still thing was really great. I think I could do my own take on that.
Yeah.
I think there is to a degree some of that, but on the other side of that, I think he saw it as a vessel to add his own creativity and to tell his own story and the way he felt about being in the military. And the way he felt about not being able to talk about certain things or not being, you know, or UFOs or conspiracies. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's actually some fairly kind of subversive stuff in Plan 9 from that regard, which had heretofore been unseen in films, the sort of Roswell kind of cover up associated with an alien encounter. Yeah. You know, I think Ed Wood kind of blew the lid on that. I think that to a certain degree, I mean, it's an industry and I can understand going, okay, well, you know, people like movies with sharks in them right now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think I lost you.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you now. Yeah.
Okay. Where did I drop off?
You completed a thought about,
whether if you have a story to tell or something to bring to this thing that's real popular right now.
Yes. Yeah. You'd completed the thought. I think you were just about to start something else and that's where the connection kind of lagged out a bit. And it was only for like a couple of seconds.
All right.
So we'll be okay there.
Yeah. How was that? Is that okay? Am I making any sense? I don't know.
You're making perfect sense. You're making a lot of sense to me, but you know.
Again, it is an industry. People say it all the time and people like to complain because, you know, that this country was built on complaining. You know, people always go, oh, well, you can't complain. It's like, no. You can always complain.
Mm-hmm.
Complaining is free. But the idea of it is that, you know, if all you're doing is complaining, you're just putting negativity out there and you're not really looking at what the real issues are. You know, people always complain, oh, they don't make movies like they used to, or, you know, kids today don't like the kinds of movies that we liked when we were kids. And, you know, that's a bunch of old man kind of grumpusing that just happens in every generation.
Yeah.
You know? And at a certain point, you have to look at things in a different way. You know, it's like, you know, I remember when the Twilight movies came out, it was very popular to smash those movies and make fun of them.
Still
and again,
is.
It's very fashionable too. And I, you know, but to be honest, they don't have my money. I didn't see them. I don't have a lot to talk about. When I watched it, it was very clear who that audience was and that I wasn't part of that audience.
Right. And that's okay, too. You know, movies need to be for everybody and every movie is not for me.
Right. Right. And the thing is
so
that,
if that's for tweens and soccer moms and they enjoy it, God bless them.
Right. Right. I don't think that it's like, you know, how dare you make a vampire movie for teenage girls and soccer and their mothers.
Right.
You know, the thing is that I remember when Lost Boys came out.
Yeah.
And I was a a teenager, I think, when Lost Boys came out. And or I might have been a little older, but I think I was a later teenager when Lost Boys came out.
Yeah.
And it was the same thing. I mean, their blood was glitter in Lost Boys, you know? Mm-hmm. And it was this, oh, this is a girl's movie. And I remember feeling like that, that Lost Boys was a girl's movie. And yeah. It's funny how time has improved that movie, where I will sit down and watch Lost Boys and go, man, this is a damn good movie. You know, so my whole turnabout, I did a whole turnabout on that movie because it's not threatening me anymore, you know? Yeah. It was
also bold for something that I had noticed, and I really believe it's in there. I really haven't heard anybody speak about it. But the Corey Haim character was gay.
Oh yeah. The Rob Lowe poster in his room and all mm-hmm. that. Yeah. I mean, yeah.
And
his
fashion sense and a few other things in there with it not being a caricature.
Yes. Yes. I think that there was a lot of that with 80s horror film, later 80s horror films, because I think it was a way to, with a strong allegory, approach that kind of thing of, okay, there's something about me that I can't tell you about.
Right.
You know? And I think werewolf movies and vampire movies always make great allegories for, you know, the struggle of a teenage person who's gay.
Mm-hmm. And in Lost Boys, conformity meant becoming a vampire.
Yes.
The vampire community was the majority.
Right.
And everybody else from there was different.
Right. Yes. Yes, I'm seeing what you're saying. Yeah, for sure.
I do think we are winding down, though.
Okay, that's fine.
unless you have more.
Yeah. No, I just capping off. I think that, again, you know, we have complaints about things. But, you know, ultimately you're dealing with an industry that's fed by money.
Yes.
And people aren't willing to put their money where their mouth is. You know, there was whenever there's a movie, the independent movie that comes out with a, you know, with practical effects and an in-suit, you know, monster suit creature, no one goes to see it. No one spends their money on it, you know, even just to support it so that there'll be more. And mm-hmm. so, you know, and then everybody comes out with this, oh, CGI is evil and evil CGI and CGI is so terrible and those artists should be dragged out in the street and shot. It's like, you know, that's not unfair. I mean, I know a lot of computer animators and they're geniuses and I can't do the work that they do. And I think that computer animation is marvelous. And mm-hmm. I've always been impressed by computer animation. I've always thought computer animation was a way to achieve things that can't be achieved any other way. Right. I think it's sad when you've only got one kind of paint in your paint box and you're trying to do every single effect with CGI when practical effects would work better or more mm-hmm. convincingly. But,
it's a two-edged sword in a lot of ways. And of course, you know, I'm a fan. You know, I do a lot of my own computer graphics work.
Right.
It's a kind of a two-edged sword, and it's also got to be used correctly. I mean, I'm sure you recall how many stuntmen used to die on movies all the time.
Sure, and that was not acceptable either.
And if you had a big action movie like Lethal Weapon or something like that, almost always it would start with "in memory of," and it would be whatever the stuntman that died on that movie.
Right.
Well, we don't have to do that anymore.
Right.
You know, but at the same time, if you build your world, then you have to stay in the confines in it. If you're going to make a gritty horror movie, a gritty, realistic, you know, raw, Last House on the Left kind of a thing, then yes. you have to stay in the confines of that world. And if suddenly you start throwing CG blood around, you've broken the rules and it stands out.
Well, sure. And I get a lot of that is just, it's not the CGI. It's just the whole direction of the film that's flawed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you're right. I agree with you. And it always kills me that like the last act of every movie has to go crazy because it's supposed to be 3D or IMAX or whatever. So, you know, in the last act, it's like the roof caves in and, mm-hmm. you know, things go flying at the screen and, you know, all these things, impossible leaps and impossible things start happening just because, you know, they can. And you know, it's a two-way street. You know, my job as the viewer is to come to a movie with a certain amount of suspension of disbelief.
Right.
And, you know, Ed Wood certainly counted a lot on people's suspension of disbelief. And in fact, he gave the audience a lot of credit because he comes from the world of stage where two people sitting in front of a shower curtain on a stage are in an airplane.
Yeah.
You know, a flying saucer on a string for a stage show is a flying saucer. And in Japanese films, a toy boat in a bathtub is a real battleship. And the reason that is because the audience understands that this is standing in for something and that we are supposed to complete that by suspending our disbelief. Mm-hmm. And I think as a country or as a culture, we've kind of lost a lot of that. We're expecting to be fooled. We want to be fooled by a movie as being reality. We don't want to suspend our disbelief. So I think that there's that aspect of it on the one side. And then on the other side, I think that at a certain point, you know, if you're going so far, you know, where you're having every character flying over treetops and, you know, so many things kind of happening that seem out of place for that world thrown at you all in the last act. I think that, you know, you're kind of, you know, you're shaking your audience out. You know, your audience has met you halfway and suspended their disbelief. And now you're just forcing them to drop their suspension of disbelief altogether.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Does that make any sense?
It totally does. Yeah. And that's where it makes it just kind of fall down because again, you've broken your own rules. And you can make up any rules that you want when you're making a movie, but once you've got it, you got to stay with it.
I like the I don't know what you thought of the Sin City movies, but I think that was a great way to approach something that's, you know, creating a completely unreal environment and then just kind of staying with it.
The first one was awesome. The first one was absolutely awesome.
Yeah.
And really made me feel like I was in a comic book.
Yeah.
In a way that the Avengers does not.
Yeah, it's true.
You know, it. I mean, it's a comic book movie, and that's great, and I love it. But it does not make me feel like I am in a comic book the way right. Sin City does.
Yeah. No, I agree. I haven't seen the second one. Actually, I think I did see a little bit of the second one, and it was not didn't quite seem to be gelling. But I do think that that's an interesting way of telling a story where you can kind of. You know, you're creating an alternate reality mm-hmm. and something that allows you to sort of bend the laws of time and physics, and it all makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. And if it suddenly shifted to Leave It to Beaver, now you've broken the rule, and now you're looking at something, and it's like, this doesn't fit with everything else. I don't like this anymore.
Yeah, a bait and switch is a big problem. Right now with movies, because I think that, you know, you have situations where I think that's why people are so resistant to reboots and reimaginings and remakes is because, you know, you're drawing people in on a certain promise and then you're not fulfilling the expectation. You know, if you're bringing people in on Godzilla, people expect certain things that if you don't certain deliverables, if you're making a Batman movie, people expect certain deliverables and, you know, the way that the industry works, there's so much red tape where, oh, well, we don't want to be too close to this other interpretation or we don't want to have to give this other person money, or, you know, there's a million screenplays on file with the Writers Guild that we don't want our version to be anything like anything else that anyone else has ever written on the subject. Yeah. And so you've got these things that are so far from anyone's expectation that they feel like they've been, it's been bait and switch. It's like, wait, I came in here to see, you know, fill in the blank superhero or fill in the blank genre character or genre period. And this is nothing like anything I paid to see.
I am pretty liberal when it comes to reboots, reimaginings, all of that, because, you know, if one is done well, it's done astoundingly well. Like The Thing or The Fly and a few others.
Yes. Sure. Even the 80s Blob is great, I think.
Yeah. Other than that, if it's not done well, then it's just another forgettable movie, just like any other forgettable movie. And I wasn't hurt by that. You know?
No. And I'm very I mean, again, I've been put into a position where I've suddenly had to defend remakes and reimaginings because I'm in the Plan 9 remake.
Yeah.
And I feel like that with every remake and every reimagining and every, you know, these are our folk tales. These are our stories that we revisit and tell to a new generation. And every time that story is told, the story perpetuates and it continues. And people always look back to the original, and mm-hmm. and the original always gets a boost every time. I mean, every time, you know, when the Tim Burton Ed Wood movie, Ed Wood's work got another boost. You know, when The Fly came out, the original Fly got a boost.
Yeah.
You know, it always, you know, Little Shop of Horrors, on and on and on. You know, anytime there's any sort of attention, anytime that vein is opened up again, mm-hmm. it draws people. It people follow that thread all the way back, and I think that you know, we have to have that thread keep going. Going because that thread goes both directions. It takes those projects into the future, and a lot of franchises and a lot of stories have been long forgotten. And because, you know, God help those people, but a lot of people can't watch black and white movies for whatever reason. Mm. A lot of people can't watch things unless they're HD. You know, you've got a generation of people who won't take the time to hear that story because. A classic is something that everybody wants to talk about, but nobody wants to see. and I think that, you know, again, the Gus Van Sant remake of Psycho, where it's shot for shot and it's exactly the same movie in color, you know, that was a failure too. You know, and to a large extent, because he didn't add anything to it.
I've never heard this for a fact or anything like that, but. I get a strong feeling that Gus Van Sant did that just to prove a point, you know, like he was not trying to put it out like, look at my Psycho, you know, I think he was kind of trying to make a point that remakes are kind of stupid.
You know, I don't know.
And I don't totally agree with that, but that's how it strikes me. Cause why else would you do a shot for shot remake?
I think that obviously he's a fan of Alfred Hitchcock, and I think that maybe he felt, you know, and again, obviously he personally felt that he couldn't top what was already done, but he could improve the technology, I guess, you know, and include a few things that Hitchcock wanted to do, like the masturbation, which were permitted at that time. So, you know, I mean, that was more like a love letter, and I get it, but I don't know that it really added anything, but it didn't really take anything away either. Psycho still stands as a classic, and a lot of people revisited Psycho, and a lot of people got into heated, angry arguments defending Psycho. And in the end, the focus is Psycho, and Psycho is, is worth focusing on because it's one of our greats.
Yeah. The one movie I personally would love to remake that I really want to do one day.
Let's do it.
Creation of the Humanoids.
Let's do it. I'm ready.
Oh, man. Ready. I love that. And not only do I want to remake it, I want everybody to remake it because there is so much that you can take away from that movie. So much that you can interpret with that movie that I think if 100 people did 100 remakes, you would have 100 completely different and interesting movies.
Well, and I feel that same way about Plan 9, you know? I mean, you know, I would invite everyone to do a Plan 9 remake. Because I think there is a lot of different things you can come away with.
Yeah. Yeah. I had a Plan 9 remake on my drawing board for a while. And that's when you started doing yours. And I was like, I'm going to put this aside for a while. And I might go back to it.
Well, and you know, mine isn't really mine either. You know, I didn't write it. It was presented to me. I would have written a totally different film. Was I proud of the work that I did? Yes. Mm-hmm. Do I want everyone to go see it? Yes. Mm-hmm. Is it the movie that I would have sat down and made if someone said you need to remake Plan 9? No, I wouldn't have. I probably would have made it a period movie. I probably would have expanded on that universe of the cops, because really I kind of feel like they're the storytellers. They're the Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. You know, I kind of feel like that would be like, wouldn't that be a great like TV show just about the precinct of those cops just going out on different kind of goofy things all the time? You know, yeah. I just think that that's like the heart of that movie are the cops. But I don't know why I feel that way. And then I love Criswell, of course. And, you know, again, I think that that's the thing that people forget about Plan 9 is that it is we're watching a reenactment on Criswell's TV show. The Criswell starts it off. We're in his TV show. Criswell predicts at the beginning. What we're watching is based on secret testimony, and the production values are very equivalent to TV live TV production values of that time. And it's kind of like we're watching probably one of the first found footage movies in Plan 9. Is that this is all taking place on Criswell's TV show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I wanted to take the peaceful aliens and really kick them back and just loosen them up and have a spaceship, have a flying saucer that's, you know, that's not Star Trek. It's just all full of like throw pillows and curtains, kind of like Genie's bottle in I Dream of Genie.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Because we always keep seeing the same interpretation of spaceships and things like this. And I was like, no, these are aliens. Let's run with that.
I like that. I like that. Sort of they could kind of all share. They already had the skater outfits on. You know, they could kind of share that Woods obsession with fabrics. You know, I could totally see that.
Yeah.
The genie bottle spaceship. That sounds marvelous. I like that approach.
Yeah, and basically us, in the arms race and nuclear weapons and all that, we're harshing their mellow. That's what the problem is.
yeah, I can see it.
And they need to do something about it.
yeah. Well, you know, they are. There's a little bit there. I think you're definitely working off of some themes that are somewhat exist there with the aliens. You know, they definitely are a little softer than us. And they're not very good at waging war, clearly, if this is their plan.
Yeah.
These guys are lovers, not fighters, I think, at heart.
Yeah.
And, you know, they're very critical of the humankind's machismo and macho-ness. You know, it seems like that they're kind of above that, you know. So, you know, I think you've got some good points. I'd like to see that. I'd like to see that interpretation. You should take it down off the shelf.
I might have to. They're all in the cabinet right over there. I'm pointing at a podcast. Don't ever do that.
You never know what could happen.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. Well, I guess we're coming up on 2 hours. You know, should we mercifully put an end to this?
Well, for the Pope on Film, that makes it a short episode.
Oh, I forgot. Reverend Steve is probably more of a talker than I am.
But I've had a blast. I've had an absolute blast sitting here talking with you today, and I thank you so much for being on our show.
Absolutely. I hope I didn't run over you. That was not my intent.
Oh no. That's fine. No. Ed McMahon, remember?
I always feel like I'm at a psychological. Yeah, Ed McMahon. I just always feel like I'm at a psychological disadvantage when I'm Skyping, and I don't. It's hard to know when I should talk and when I shouldn't, especially when I can't see the person that I'm talking to.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I do the show with Reverend Steve, so I know how to interrupt when I need to.
Well, you know, I really think the world of both of you guys. I think you guys are doing Wood's work, and you know, hopefully there'll be some opportunities in the future for us to do things together, you know, where you and I will spend the rest of our lives.
Yes. So thank you all for tuning in, and join us for the regular episodes of The Pope on Film, released every Monday. And we'll see you then, you godless heathens.
Praise Wood.
Do you like comic books?
Me too.
Do you listen to podcasts?
Are you still talking to me?
Cool. I have one called The Comic Book Update.
So?
I do weekly reviews of story arcs, comic miniseries, ongoing titles, and more.
I don't care.
I know, right? So all you have to do is go to the website at comicbookupdate.com.
Why would I do that?
We post daily previews of new comic books every day.
Ugh, someone save me.
And every weekend is Cosplay Sunday, with blog posts featuring cosplayers from around the world.
Excuse me, miss, is this guy bothering you?
Back off, buddy. She's with me.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Sorry. Nerd rage.
Oh, yeah.
So check out The Comic Book Update at comicbookupdate.com, as well as on iTunes, and stream it live on Stitcher. The Comic Book Update, the antidote for nerd rage.
Today, storms possible. Tomorrow, storms possible. The next day, storms likely. The day after that, storms possible. The day after that, storms.